So I spoke on the spirit of Absalom and I explained the spirit. Now today I'll be speaking on Absalom. So I will not go back to the spirit because it was a 1 hour sermon. But I beg you in God's holy name, whatever I'm saying now may not make sense until you go and watch the video on YouTube. Because I explained the word spirit. And I told us in church there are four categories, four ways of understanding the word spirit, human spirit. So I'm not going to go into that. But the second text is 2 Samuel chapter 15. And I have 10 traits of Absalom. 10 traits. And there are Absaloms everywhere. So we're going to read 2 Samuel chapter 15. The first John 4 says, my brethren, believe not every spirit. That was where I started from. Believe not every spirit. And no spirit speak to us. It's preachers that speak to us. It's human beings that speak to us. But today, we're going to look at the word Abraham, Absalom, the man Absalom. Chapter 15. God. Hallelujah. From verse number 1. Are you ready? The text flows from chapter 14, verses 28. But I'm not going to go to chapter 14. I'll read from chapter 15. And it came to pass, after that, Absalom prepared in chariots and horses, and 50 men to run before him. And Absalom rose up early and stood beside the way of the gate. And it was so that when any man that had a controversy came to the king for judgment, then Absalom called unto him and said, of what city art thou? And he said, thy servant is of one of the tribes of Israel. And Absalom said to him, see, thy matters are good and right, but there is no man deputed of the king to hear thee. No deputy. Absalom said, moreover, oh, that I were made judge in the land. Wow, if I was judge, every man which has a suit or cause might come unto me, and I will do him justice. Next verse. And it was so that when any man came near to him to do him obeisance, he put forth his hand and took him and kissed him. That's how kings were worshipped and serenaded in the past. And on this manner did Absalom to all Israel that came to the king for judgment. So Absalom stole the hearts of the men of Israel. Stole. You can woo hearts, you can steal hearts. I don't want to be a heart thief. The next verse. And it came to pass after 40 years that Absalom said to the king, I pray thee, let me go and pay my vow, which I vowed to the Lord in Hebron. Next verse. And thy servant vowed a vow, which I abode when I abode in Jeshur in Syria, saying, if the Lord shall bring me again indeed to Jerusalem, then will I serve the Lord. And the king said to him, go in peace. That's David. So, and he arose and went to Hebron. And Absalom sent spies throughout all the tribes of Israel, saying, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then you shall say, Absalom reigns in Hebron. And with Absalom went 200 men out of Jerusalem, the headquarters. They were called, and they went in their simplicity or naivety, and they knew not what they were doing. And Absalom sent for Ahithophel, the Gilonite, David's chief counselor, from his city, even from Gilo, while he offered sacrifices, and the conspiracy was strong, for the people increased continually with Absalom. Lord, we pray that you give us a blessing of insight, of unction, in Jesus' name. You can have your sin in God's presence. The spirit of Absalom. You will do me good to go to chapter 14, verse number 25, media. So I will read that on my own so I can explain to everybody a few things about this gifted, charismatic fellow. This man in chapter 14. So this is the background to chapter 15. Let me tell you a bit more about this guy called Absalom. He was the son of David. And Bible says in all Israel there was none to be so much praised as Absalom for his beauty. Please note verse 15, because that is where the problem started from. This is where the problem started from. This is it. That's a verse. From the sole of his foot even to the crown of his head, there was no blemish in him. Oh, please note that. I'm going to speak on that in a short while, actually. That verse 25 is the foundation of Absalom's problem. So for people that have the spirit of Absalom, they must understand verse 25. That's where it all started from. Charismatic, strong, beautiful, tall, handsome, gifted, talented, respected, praised, celebrated. That's where it all starts from. People, and Absalom was a son. So we don't have Absaloms in the church. There are no sons. There are sons that those close to the power, those close to us, those respected, those revered, those gifted and talented, they had the Absaloms. Nobody can possess the spirit of Absalom without beauty, without charisma, without strength, without celebrity gifts, without talent. It's because that's where it is. This guy, none, is to be so much praised as Absalom in the entire country or nation called Israel. That's why I'm always careful with the gifted, including myself. I'm always wary of the gifted, including myself. For those of us that are much more gifted, talented, skilled, we are the ones that have the potential and proclivity to betray others, to try to tell our fathers, I can do what you're doing. You know why? I'm as gifted as you are. I'm as praised as you are. I'm as loved as you are. People know me, that nobody in this house is as good as I am. Gifts can deceive. Gifts can deceive. So I'm going to come back to the gifted, because the first point about Absalom was the guy was gifted. Well, let's read fast. Let's read a little bit down. So we're going to go back to my text. I was just reading, and I'll come back to the gifted part. Verse 26. It's important for you to understand this. 26. Next verse. And when he pulled his head. No, verse 26. The next verse. 14, verse 26. 2 Samuel 14, 26. Give me that, give it to me. I want to read down to verse number 30, 34. When he bowed his head, for it was every year's end that he bowed it, because the air was heavy on him, was so brilliant. Therefore, he bowed it. He weighed the air of his head 200 shekels, 200 shekels after the king's weight. Next verse. And some died. And unto Absalom, there was born 3 sons and 1 daughter, whose name was Tamar. She was a woman of fair countenance. And so Absalom dwelt 2 full years in Jerusalem and saw not the king's face. Next verse. Therefore, Absalom sent for Joab, the uncle, to have him sent to the king. He would not come to him when he sent again the second time. He would not come. Joab was too busy at work. Therefore, he said to his servants, see, Joab's field is near my own field. And he has barley there. Go set it on fire. And Absalom's servant set the field on fire. Can you imagine? And Joab arose and came to Absalom, to himself, and said to him, wherefore have thy servant set my field on fire? And Absalom answered to Joab, behold, I sent for thee and to come to me, and let me send thee to the king to say, wherefore am I come from Geshur? It had been good for me to have been there still. Now therefore let me see the king's face, and if there be any iniquity in me, let him kill me. And that was why. And Joab came to the king and told him what he had called, when he had called for Absalom. And he came to the king and bowed himself to the face of the ground of the king, and the king kissed Absalom. Now listen to me. The background story is this. There was a guy called Amnon, the firstborn son of David. Firstborn son of David. And he fell in love. He had lust for his own sister, Tamar. And so the story cut short. He called for Tamar. And you know the story in 2 Kings 13. And he raped Samuel. And he raped Tamar. And after he raped Tamar, Tamar happened to be the sister of Absalom. He raped Tamar and he pushed Tamar out. Raped and rejected. So what's worse than rape is rejection. So after he rejected Tamar, Absalom heard and said, don't worry, I'm going to take vengeance on this guy. So he waited many years. So be very careful with deadly people that keep quiet and keep calm when you offend them. They are more deadly. So they won't raise the issue, but they know what they're doing. So Absalom kept quiet, and many years after, Absalom did a party. He called all the princes. He was targeting one. He called all the princes, all the sons of the king, and he killed all of them. David heard, and David was angry. So David exiled him. You're my son. You're my most loved son. The most gifted of all my children. The most talented, the most skilled. But you know what? You're banished. So he banished him from headquarters, and he went to Syria, another country. He was in Syria for many years, and then kept sending for Joab, his uncle, who happened to be the major general, one of the captains and generals of David's army. And was a son of Zeruiah. Zeruiah was a sister of David. So one of the sisters of David from Jesse. So it was a family thing. So Joab came to the king. King, look, your son has been out there. Joab sent a woman to pretend. And the woman came to say, oh, beautiful stories. Oh, 2 sons of mine, oh king, were striving in a battle. And one of them was killed mistakenly, the other. And then the people said, justice must be served on the second son. For the law of the land says we must kill the second son, because the second son killed the first son. Murder must not go away unpunished. So the king said, oh, no, 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 they can't do that to you. How do you mean? Tell them, I, the king, have executed forgiveness. Go home, daughter. Nothing will happen. Then she said, king, why are you doing this to us? The same thing happens to you. So what? How do you mean? Absalom, your son, killed your sons, yet you have banished Absalom. So tell me, is Joab behind this? Say, yes, my lord, Joab sent me. Okay, you know what? You're forgiven. Bring Absalom back. So Absalom came back to town. However, you're back in Israel, out of exile, but don't come to Jerusalem. Stay somewhere in Geshur, another land. But you're in Israel. You don't come to headquarters. And Absalom stayed for 2 years and said, what do you mean? How can I be in Israel but I can't see the king? I deserve to see the king. Even though he has forgiven me, I want more. So he started sending for Joab. Joab, please come. I want to see my father. And Joab did not come because he was busy with state matters. So he set a place on fire. And then every other thing is what we have there. Eventually, that led to father saying, okay, come, my son. You can come back to Jerusalem. From exile to Geshur, Geshur to Jerusalem. But from Jerusalem, what was he looking for? The throne. You get it? From exile to Geshur, Geshur, Jerusalem. Jerusalem to what? The throne. I want more. In fact, I want your seat. I want your own seat. You've forgiven me. I want your seat now. So I'm going to share with you some few thoughts from the man Absalom. I call it spirit because it's an attitude Christians do have. Everybody, even in workplace, even in offices. So this is the nature of man. Whether you are born again or dead again, you can have the spirit of Absalom. Is that clear? Now, so I said, you need to understand the word spirit. It's not Holy Spirit. It's not demonic spirit. So when I say spirit of Absalom, I'm not saying demonic spirit. No. It's not a demonic spirit, it's an attitude. It's something that we all do every now and then. It's a bit of greed. We just have it. It's our human spirit, not my human spirit, but an attitude, an approach to doing things. So many Christians have the approach of Absalom because it's a human nature that we need to kill. The old man needs to be killed. We now have a new man, but we have the old man struggling with the new man in church. Even though I'm born again, but the old man is still around. So the old man and the new man are always fighting and struggling and wrestling every day. So I'm struggling. What I want to do, I find myself not doing it. What I don't want to do, I find myself doing it. That shows that there's an old man in me struggling with the new man. And the new man wants to show up every time, but the old man tries to push and surprise the new man. So the old man is what we're talking about, the spirit of Absalom. So the first point there, and media, I sent them something to me project. The first point about this man and his treachery. Don't forget what I said earlier on. There are gifted and talented people who will never get involved in doing ministry unless they are in charge and in control. My father in the Lord, Bishop Mike, told me this many years ago. We were discussing one great man of God. And he said, do you know the problem with that man? I said, no, sir. He said, if you see a man of God who is gifted, talented, anointed, but will never get involved in anything ministry except unless he is in charge, run. That's the spirit of Absalom. And there are people like that. They're so gifted, talented, and anointed. But the only time they will get involved in anything is when they're in charge. The moment they say, can we all come together and do it? If they are not the president, the chairman, the main person, they will pull away and say, I don't think so. Because the idea is that I'm too gifted to submit. I'm too talented to work with others. Others work with me. Am I communicating? I'm too skilled to be one of them. I should be outside one of them. They should all be around me. Everything should be built around me. Be careful. There are people like that. It's something that is very deadly and dangerous. You won't even know it, you have it. You won't even know you carry it. You won't even know you're doing it. That's why Paul said to the Roman church in chapter 12, verse 3, he said, a man should not think of himself more. I'm not saying don't think of himself well, more highly than he ought to. One preacher said, every gift that God gives to us cannot be an achievement. Every gift that God gives to you cannot be an achievement. You can never come and say, I achieved this, because he gave it to you free. How can you call a gift an achievement? It's given to you freely. How can you not say a talent is an achievement? Except you know that if you you gave it yourself, then fantastic. Everything I have is a gift. I can't say I've achieved it, because I don't need to struggle to flow in it. So I always go to say, thank you, Baba, for giving it to me. Because it's not an achievement. I didn't go to school to learn it. Are you with me? So it's just gift. So now we find this guy extremely gifted, charismatic. So my first point is gifted and charismatic. Absalom had no blemish in beauty, but corrupted and blemished in character, like Satan, who tried to upstage his master. Don't forget the first law of power in Robert Greene's book, never outshine your master. That was what the devil did. In Ezekiel 28, verse 11 to 17, the Bible describes Ezekiel just like who? Satan, just like who? Absalom. Perfect in beauty. The devil was perfect in beauty. Similar to what Absalom had, perfect in beauty. Solid, gifted, talented, skilled, powerfully, you know, graced by God. The Bible called him the anointed cherub. So Satan said, wait a minute, I'm too gifted to serve him. I can be him. Are you with me? I can be one him. I'm too good. I'm too good to be one of them. I can't be one of them. I'm too good. I'm just too good for that. I'm too gifted, too graced, too talented, too skilled to be in this choir. Look at them in this choir. Which one of them is as good as I am? Tell me. Tell me. When I hold microphone to sing, if I start with a note, the anointing will flow. I'm too much. I'm too much. That was it. Be careful, let not your gifts deceive you. Let not your talents ruin you. Let not your skills destroy you. The same skill you have today can destroy you tomorrow. People can say, I don't want him. It's a foul smell. Foul smell. The skills and the grace you carry can become foul smell before the Lord and before man if you operate under the spirit of what? Absalom. So number one, he was a gifted and charismatic person like the devil. Does that make sense? Number two, he felt entitled. The second point is the spirit of Absalom is an entitled spirit. Do you know what he did? Absalom had an entitlement attitude to the presence of the king, despite the fact that he had committed a treasonable offense by killing the princes, unlike the prodigal son, who has to be a servant, not a son. Can you see two of them in Luke 15? Absalom came back from Geshur. He said, why is he leaving me banished? Why is come? Come, tell this king, why would he leave me banished? What nonsense is that? I want to be here. Tell him to bring me back. Entitled. Entitled to your presence. And that's why I'm always wary, Nancy, when you see members, sons, everybody, entitled to your presence. No one entitled me. They say, I'm entitled to be with you, regardless of what I do or what I did. Even if I kill everybody, before Fota started, I started Fota with you. Have you seen people that have been here? They were in Fota before Fota. Before Fota started, I am here. Entitled. Be careful. Absalom told the king, I'm entitled to your presence. Every time I read that passage, I'm not scared. The guy should be happy. Look at the prodigal son. What did he say? I'm not even worthy to be a son anymore. Let me be a servant. Baba, do I'm a son from your loins? A few years ago, I demanded for my inheritance. Now, I feel I've done wrong. Can I be a servant? I beg to apply for service in your house. How can a son request to be a servant? He said, I'm not entitled to your forgiveness. I ruined, destroyed, and with my prodigal lifestyle, wasted your hard-hand resources. The gift you gave to me, I destroyed it. Lord, forgive me. Be careful with people that have entitlement spirit. You got to be very careful. Because you got to be very careful. I'm always wary of them. Next. The third point, write it down. Attention seeking. Oh no, my time is up. I'm going to preach this sermon. This sermon, I will banish TLA for second service. Please, no TLA today. No, no TLA today. I'm going to continue. Attention seeking. This is going to help your life. Third major issue with people that have spirit of Absalom. They always seek attention. Absalom set the field of Joab on fire to get his attention. There are people who don't mind causing troubles and disaster for attention. They can do anything when they crave some people's attention. They don't mind destroying the house. They don't mind destroying the whole field. Just don't be seen or heard. Run. Spirit of... He set the whole field on fire. Why? Attention. Are they here? Even when they came, I said, why did you stay my field of fire? When I was asking for you to come, you didn't come. What do you mean? And you don't mind causing disaster? Yes. Why? I am Absalom. I want to see you. You don't see me. You must see me. Attention seekers are dangerous people. Spirit of Absalom. And people, there are people everywhere. They don't mind destroying the marriage just to get attention. They don't mind destroying the choir just to get attention. They know. Do you know what I'm doing? They will destroy it. Why? I'm here. I want them to know I'm here. Why I'm entitled? I want attention. Why? If they're not giving it to you, just wait. God will bring it to you. No, I want to be seen. Well, I'm here. Be careful from those who set the field on fire just to be heard. Just to be heard. I'm always afraid of them. And you will know that you just want to set the field on fire. You are getting my point. God will honor him. Just to get attention, they will set the field on fire. And most times, we're so naive and gullible, we give them the... That's why sometimes I make some decisions that people don't understand. I refuse to give their attention. I will go and set the fire, okay. Quench the fire, I'll not give attention. Because I know what you want is attention. I set feed, he don't give me. I go set house on fire. Let me not set the house on fire. Then I will not give attention. Why I will go come? Voice that our lives on fire. What do you want? Attention. What is it? I want to tell you that last week in the choir or in the usher, somebody shouted at me. Is that why you did all this? Yes. Why you got all this? Yes. Okay, we are sorry. Let's now continue the ministry. That's all. Pastor, you cannot say you are sorry. They will set the house. How many of you get something here? Are you getting something? Are you sure? They will set the house on fire. They don't mind, Jola. Destroy the department. Destroy this place. Just to get the... And it's a church. And it's a house. And it's your office. Even your office is there. Even politics is there. I won't mention their names. You can see them on TV. They will say PDP will be destroyed if I get their attention. APC will destroy if I don't get attention. They will say we will set this party on fire. So give them attention. They will just say, they're here. Attention. Very frightening. It's not frightening. You are laughing. Have I mentioned name now? Look at this person. Oh, the spirit. I'm talking, she's laughing. As if she's getting ministered to by what I'm saying. And you know I've not mentioned anybody's. She can now. Number four. Visibility. In chapter 15, verse 1. Chapter 15, verse 1. All he wanted was visibility to be seen. Absalom prepared horses, chariots, 50 people to run ahead of him. He needed to be visible. Be wary of people who want to be visible only and won't work when not visible. They won't do anything. 50. I want to be visible. Chariots, be around me. So immediately he came back and the father said, okay, come to Jerusalem. What did he do? Visibility. Visibility. Let them know I'm around. How can they know I'm around? What can I do to show them I'm around? They will come in last, or they will come in with a pomp. Many years ago, when I got married to my wife, there was this person that always go to church very, very late, and the person would walk into the auditorium with something. And I asked my wife, why is this person doing this? Say, likes to be seen. Say, it's not good to enter church, people don't know you're around. So I'm telling the person, say, it's not good to go enter church, and nobody know you are there. Let them know when they are all seated, you're now going a bit late. You now deliberately walk, you go to the front, there's no seat there. No, you go to the front looking for seats, you now go to the back. Usher cannot stop you. You are walking on this. I'm around. It's visibility project. A personal visibility project. I'm around. Kuna, you know them, don't you? And there's no way you will not know they have come. So all of us know they have we have seen you. Even the preacher preaching, we know we have seen you. Can you not go and see them? Yes, I'm around. So, and 15 minutes they leave. So you can't say, I didn't come to church. Well, everybody saw me. The day they're not in church, we know. Because they won't do that thing. Visibility. Spirit of the next. Are you getting something? Are you writing down? The next, gatekeeping or gatekeeper. Verse 2 of 2 Samuel 15. Absalom became a gatekeeper for the sole purpose of wanting people to know him and hear their pleas. There are many reasons that makes people want to be gatekeepers. To help filter those that see the king. To be seen at the gate before seeing the king. To usurp the king's authority at the gate. Many reasons. There are many gatekeepers, even in our church. Many even in our church. People just say, no, how can you go and see Reverend without going through us? You must go through me to see Reverend. They stay right there to filter the news that comes out of the palace. To know every man going in and coming out. So if you want to get information, you go and see them as gatekeepers. They can tell you, no, she has not come today. Sister Diamina, I have not seen her. Because anybody that enters, I know. And when they come out, I seem to know what they go and discuss. How do you know? Have you bugged pastor's office? I have not bugged it. How do you know? I have a way of knowing. Don't worry. I'm a gatekeeper. So do you get the point? Absalom stood by the gate. By the gate! You can't go in or come out without going through me. Some people play to the gallery, and everyone is right, but no one is wrong. Gatekeepers. Did you notice that in that passage, Absalom would never tell anybody you are wrong. He said, I want to listen to your plea so I can tell you are right. Read it very well. He tells them, you're always right. You're always right. You're always right. You see, verse 3. And Absalom said to him, see, thy matters are good and right, but there is no man deputed to the king to hear thee. Can you imagine? How can everybody? So anybody that comes to see the king through him, where you come, he tells them, your matters are good and right. I'm always careful of leaders that when they judge cases, never find people guilty. Two fighting, one person is wrong. You tell A, you are right. You tell B, you are right. So who is wrong? So both of them go back and say they are both right. Because you want to be good and kind. You want them to like you. You want them to like you. So he said, A, you are right. B, you are right. They now go and meet Reverend and I say, you are wrong. I don't like Reverend because this man said I'm right. Because Reverend tells you the truth, you are wrong. My sister, you are wrong. I'm not trying to please you. I love you, but I'll tell you the truth. Absalom did not tell anybody, say you are right. Always. Everybody's always right. And two are fighting. And the two fighting, they're always right. Somebody must be wrong. Do you get the point? Gatekeepers. Gatekeepers. And people know them. They know these are the gatekeepers. You can't go in without them. If you're going to go in, go through them. And so people go and meet the gatekeepers for favors. They go and meet, they cut their favors, they cut their presence. They make the gatekeepers even as strong, sometimes more powerful than even the king. Gatekeepers. 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 So influential gatekeepers. For you to get access in there, they give you shadow, they give you appointment. Gatekeepers. Gatekeepers. They magnify their office above the throne. Gatekeepers. Because everybody comes through me to see the king. I start thinking I'm the king. Gatekeepers. I start thinking I could be king. Gatekeepers. I start thinking, why can't I be king? Gatekeepers. Gatekeepers. Be careful of those that keep your gate, because they can ruin or destroy you. Be careful of your life if you're a gatekeeper as well. Be very wary. Do not forget that the king put you there for a purpose. And in this case, the king did not put him there. He put himself. Gatekeepers. Have you seen people that put themselves at the gate without the king even being aware? Yeah. Gatekeepers. Are you not aware that they're putting themselves there? Gatekeepers. They start doing things for you that you didn't send them to do. Gatekeepers. So what did I authorize you to do that? Gatekeepers. Gatekeepers. And they're like, yes! I stand here! To know. And they'll faint. Look. The king is so busy for you. I can help him. But they ask for your help. They ask you to help me. Gatekeepers. Number five. Number what now? Six, forgive me, I beg your pardon. Thirst for office and power. Verses 3-4 of 2 Samuel chapter 15. Absalom placed emphasis on the office of the deputy more than the work of the deputy is there. He said, the king has no one deputed. Deputed, I want to be deputy. How can you desire to be deputy king? Oh, God of heaven, I feel like preaching. How can you become deputy to king when you're not concerned about the work? You're concerned about the office. For you know the office carries power and authority and influence. Am I communicating? They are in your offices. They are in your departments. They are in your ministries. They are in your workplace. They are everywhere. It's the nature of man. Nature, human beings. My one great man of God, late Archbishop, I always said it jokingly, say African man like title. Say create title for them, they work. Call this one treasurer. Call that one assistant treasurer. The other one chief assistant treasurer. The one deputy chief assistant treasurer. This one assistant deputy chief assistant treasurer. They just walk and they will go to town meeting. They will go home with that plaque. They say, my dear, I've just been given a new promotion in my office where I'm the chief assistant in my church. Chief assistant deputy treasurer of the Deacon's Board. What Deacon's Board? One. There's two. One. Their shelf and they take picture and what then they work. When they go to work, they will not want to talk. They'll say, may I talk, man of God? Yes. As the chief assistant deputy treasurer one of this great of Dickens one, Dickens Church, I've been here for 13 years. All they want to say is just be heard. When they finish talking, you will not hear anything. They will just repeat what has been said before. You get it? I support what my sister is saying. My sister said it well. And we must do it well. Uncle, why do you talk? All you are saying is to say your support. We don't this title wrapped around your head. The man said, there is nobody deputy. Look at Absalom's spirit. craving to be deputy to the king. When the man did not ask you to deputize me, spirit of is there. So be careful for the thirst. Absalom placed emphasis on that. He was so passionate about it. He thirsted for the position of a judge in the land, but he didn't go to his father, the king, to make the request. Go about it the right way. Go about it how? The right way. Ask and you shall receive, not plot and you shall take by treasury. Ask, you shall receive. If he had requested from the king, he may even have given it to him. But he plotted and he took it by treachery. Does that make sense? Somebody say, ask, you shall be received. And you shall receive, that's all. You can get what you want. You just ask for it. Don't plot to get it by treachery. Ask. 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 Number 7. 15 verses 5 to 6. In verses 5 to 6, it was very clear that he started to play the act. If you know those days, the kings would do like this, Abu would kiss it like the Pope today. So he started acting like a king even before he finished his treachery. Absalom assumed the role of the king without being sworn in. He acted the way kings greet the people, and he had not been crowned king yet. Place this hand out, people were kissing their hands. Kissing it. So be careful of people. That's what him to play the act. The spirit of Absalom are those that play the act without receiving the office, without being sworn in, without being commissioned. You get it? They play the act. They play the act. I normally crack jokes with people in church. You know, I like to crack jokes. I cause up with little G.O., small G.O. Baba Nolua, I'm on here. He's playing that degree like this. Baba Nolua, I'm on here. Baba Nolua. Are you with me? Don't play the act. You are not yet the age where music ministry. Don't act the part. Wait for your time. Don't go there and say, well, HM is not here. It's late today. I don't know why she always comes late. You know, can we all come together, please? I'm not saying don't late. I mean, is this HM? Can we all... Okay, no, excuse me, you keep quiet. Anyway, I just want to help out. You know, I can do something better. What is all this? Who made you HM? Hey! Spirit of... Number 8. This is the one I love most, and this is for all of you here and for the Gushers that will listen to me tomorrow. There are heart thieves. Christians don't know it. The day I saw it many years ago, my heart sank, and Absalom stole the hearts of the people. I shrank. I read that passage many years ago, and I knelt down before the Lord and I said, God, please try my heart. May I never be a heart thief. I don't want to steal the hearts of people from other people's churches. And there are pastors that try to steal the hearts of other members. To steal is to take what does not belong to you. The craft ways. Let me just preach the word. Let those that are called to follow me, Lord, come to this house. Let them sit there, hear the word, and say they love this man and his style. Let them be my members, and I will shepherd them from my heart to bring them to the kingdom. I will do my best, my best, to be faithful, loyal, and committed to your work. I don't want to be a heart thief. There are people that steal hearts. And that those that woo hearts, and that those that hearts just follow. Read the book. Read Samuel. When Saul was anointed in 1 Kings chapter 9, I think chapter 10, the Bible says the hearts of many who followed him. They just followed him. He was anointed. The people followed him with their hearts. They followed Saul the king. While some sons of Belial says they will not follow. I think the last chapter of chapter 10 or chapter 9, or 1 Samuel chapter 9 or 10. Their hearts, people, they followed him. That those whose God has touched their hearts, men who followed Saul as king. That's the biblical principle. People look at you and they follow you. Don't you ever steal the hearts of people. It's the spirit of Absalom. You go around in a small department, you spoil HOD, you spoil HOM, you spoil pastor, you try to act as if you are better than anybody so you can just be loved. You are a heart thief. You are stealing the hearts. Let people follow you and God touch their hearts to follow. There are people that don't follow me. Let them follow another man of God to God. Exactly. Those that God has called to follow us, we thank God. If it's just 100, we thank God. You have 20,000, thank you. The same God touched my own attitude, leave us alone. Exactly. Don't steal. Don't steal. Let God do it. Absalom was a thief. Don't forget that. He stole the hearts of the people. He stole the hearts of the people. He was a thief. Don't you ever celebrate thieves? And today, they are already planning to steal your hearts again in 2023. They know how to give you bags of rice, bags of beans, to just steal the hearts, to show that they love us. And the political class know how to do it better. And the people are naive. But what the Bible says, they were what? Naive. You see, 1 Samuel 10, and Saul also went to Gibeah, and they went with a band of men whose hearts God had touched. Can you see? God touched their hearts. But the sons of Belial refused to follow him. No problem. Even the anointed always have crisis. No problem. No wahala. No wahala. They will come and steal their hearts. They give you 5,000 to steal your heart. After they've stolen their heart. And they're naive people. Gullible. Simple. And they don't even know what they're doing. Then, number 9. Naivety and simplicity of hearts. The most vulnerable in the society are the naive and simple, who don't question leaders much. Don't forget verse 10. I told you that people that see their hearts, they told them what they wanted to hear and they stole their hearts. Don't forget, there are people that con people. I wish I could pound that heart thief. They pound, they con you. They tell you what they want to hear. Each in your generation. And I stay on the pulpit trying to steal your heart. I do a conference and I'm hoping that they will like me. So I brand myself and I tell you what you want to hear. I hear what you want to hear. I tell you what you want to hear. So you can like you and steal your heart. That's how to steal people's hearts. And they say, I'm changing church. Why? Your heart has been stolen. It's not God that touched your heart. You got a point now. Your heart has been stolen. Because Absalom said what he wanted to hear. But you must tell them what God wants them to hear. There are two different things. You're a God servant. God's servant. We must tell you what God wants you to hear, even when it's bitter. Does that make sense? We still love you. Praise God. Don't be naive. Bible says 200 men from, they didn't even know what they were doing. When I read it, I was angry. They followed, they didn't know why. They didn't know that the guy was using them. The final point, number 10, this is the strongest. Strong counselor produces strong conspiracy. You can never have the spirit of Absalom except you have an Ahithophel on your side. You must always have somebody else. The man cannot do the job alone without a friend, and that friend is a strong counselor. The Bible says, and the conspiracy became strong only when Ahithophel joined. Check it. Before Ahithophel joined, it was a weak conspiracy. Weak. So there's nobody that can upstage a king without Ahithophel in the team. Nobody can take your role except Ahithophel is with them. That's the devil himself. Extremely wise in counsel. Extremely knowledgeable in the heart of men. They know how to make win weak. They know how to win battles with words. They know how to win battles and weaken hands of men. Even mighty men are always, their hearts tremble when they know whose side Ahithophel is on. Their hearts tremble. For David, when David heard, he became weak and said, what? Ahithophel is the heart. Hey, I'm gone. If that guy is there, let's go. Ahithophel is there. He's there. Let's go. Let's pack a bag and go. But God, please turn that man's counsel to foolishness. Because that guy, he never loses battles. That guy, so cunning, crafty, wise in counsel. Any team he joins always wins and defeats others. Only God can defeat him. So that's where God comes. That's where God comes in. Only God. Now I need God more. He didn't pray until he heard Ahithophel was there. He didn't pray, Ahithophel is there. God, please, I beg. Let's go. God, that guy, I don't know how he does it. That was when he realized I have a big problem. Strong counselor produces strong conspiracy. Conspiracy became strong only when counselors are strong and wise. And that's how you know those that have the spirit of Absalom. It's a spirit. It's an attitude of getting things done. It's not demonic spirit. It's just an attitude. It's the nature of man. That's why the Bible says in Psalm 51, verse 10, 11, 12, give us that as our clothes. Those influencing you right now may be controlling you through this use of the spirit and attitude of Absalom. You're following a band and a gang without you checking, am I really doing what is right? What am I even doing? You just don't know. Because the spirit is to control and to influence you. To influence you. To control you without you knowing it. And you're being moved and swerved somewhere. You don't know that somebody is controlling you. You think you're in charge. You're not in charge. Somebody else is controlling you. They're using the wrong spirit. He says, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. We're going to pray for that. We're going to pray that prayer. That word right spirit is a human spirit. It's not the Holy Spirit. It's the attitude, sorry, the right attitude, the attitudinal spirit, not the human spirit, not the Holy Spirit, not the evil demonic spirit. It's just an attitude. Create a right spirit. Renew a right spirit within me. Because I can have a wrong spirit. I can have a spirit of Absalom. It's a wrong spirit. I can have the spirit of Jezebel. I'll teach you that later. Which is to bewitch people, to control people, to intimidate and control and manipulate people. Create in me a clean heart and renew the right spirit within me. That's a Christian's prayer. I don't want to be cunning, crafty. I don't want to renew a right spirit. But look at the next verse. My daughter, Mr. Violet, showed me the next verse later. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thine Holy Spirit. You see, the next verse speaks about the Holy Ghost. The previous verse speaks about what? The attitude. You see, two different spirits mentioned. The verse after that says, restore unto me the joy of my salvation and uphold me with thy free spirit, which is another spirit. Then verse 17, in the same passage when the man was repenting, verse 17 says a different thing entirely. Verse 17, a broken spirit, that's the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. Verse 17, please. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken spirit. So if God will accept you, it's going to be by your broken spirit. And a contrite heart thou shalt not despise. So you see, God, see, Psalm, tell you about multiple use of the word spirit. Multiple use of the word spirit. There's a free spirit, the Holy Ghost. There's a Holy Spirit. There's your attitude. And there's a human spirit. That broken spirit is a human spirit, not the attitude. That's you, because you are spirit soul. That's a human spirit. That word broken spirit, be broken on the inside. That's the one that gets saved. That's where humility comes from, character. Be broken on the inside and say, Lord, I'm broken before you. I need you. Then it's easier for you to now be renewed with the right spirit and the right attitude. Can we rise to our feet?